Migraine prophylaxis is something which is very complicated, and it has to be individualized for every single patient. So my presentation flow would be obviously trigger recognition, obviously diagnosis, obviously treatment for an acute attack, prophylaxis, what are the evidence-based guidelines and the non-pharmacological aspects of management of migraine. I'll be focusing on episodic migraine. The diagnosis, treatment and acute treatments have been the diagnosis and the acute treatment has already been taken care of, so I'll not touch that. So it is very important to identify the triggers, and many times if the patient is having very infrequent migraine attacks, then identifying of these triggers might be a very, very potent way of preventing further attacks. For example, a person says that I have headaches only when I am missing my meals, I have headaches only when I am going out in the sun, I have headaches only when I take a hair wash and I don't dry my hair. So avoiding of these triggers might actually be making him headache free or her headache free. A use of a goggle, if the patient is having headaches only when the patient is going out, those large goggles which cover up the eyes. So identification of triggers in episodic migraine where the frequency is low might be an exceptional way of management of these patients. The best way of doing that is to manage with a headache diary in patients who have episodic migraine. So what I tell them is that you go home, make your headache diary, and on the day of the headache, you mark a tick, and not only you note down what you took for the relieving of that headache, you also note down what you had consumed or what all things which you did which were out of your usual routine, and many times that helps. So these are the common triggers, we all know of them. It is practically impossible to avoid everything and become a saint, but it is possible to avoid some of these triggers by very mild lifestyle changes. The management once the diagnosis is sure would depend upon the type, the severity and the frequency of the headache, and also the lifestyle of the patient, as I've already told you. So assessment of disability is of prime importance. We never do it in our OPD settings because of our busy schedules, but it carries a very, very important implication in the long-term management of migraine, particularly when the migraine is going out of hands, it's becoming more frequent. So the two tools which are available to us are the MIDAS score and the HIT-6 score. The HIT-6 score is a 6-point score in which the least point which is possible is 6, and the maximum point which is possible is 13 on each point. So the maximum score which somebody can have would be 78, and the minimum score which somebody would have would be 36. And the higher the score, the more severe is the migraine. Currently, this is a good standard to evaluate for the impact of headache on the lifestyle and the activities of a patient. The goals of a treatment or prophylaxis should be reduce the migraine frequency and severity, reduce disability, improve the quality of life, avoid escalation of acute headache medication overuse, and educate and enable the patient to manage their disease on their own. Now, this last line is probably the single most important thing, because what would happen is that after 2 months, 3 months, 6 months, these patients will continue to ask, ki doctor sahab, kab tak dawai khani hai? So that is the single most difficult question which is to be answered by a doctor. So what is advisable is to make them aware about their disease right from the beginning. To tell them that this is not a curable disease. In fact, I tell them this is not a disease at all. I tell them that this is a condition. This is a condition which your body was destined to have right from the day when you were born. If you are going to be putting your head inside a mixer grinder, your hand is going to be crushed. So if you are going to be exposed to your particular trigger, there is no way by which you can prevent the migraine. So this is not a disease, therefore it does not require the treatment. But another way of treating is that you tell them that as long as your pain is there, you might require treatment. So you have to decide whether you want to take the medication or you want to take the migraine. But usual dictum is that we give treatment for prophylaxis for about 6 to 9 months. But it is very important that we educate the patients during this time. Pharmacotherapy for migraine is So the prophylaxis is important, but because you have to bring down that frequency to a desirable level, and the medicines, they work well provided they are taken, and it is the compliance which is the key issue, and the compliance is decided by the efficacy, the frequency of administration, the side effect, and the cost of the medication. So it is important to understand that migraine prophylaxis is very important, because 60% of migraines will have about one or more severe attacks per month, and 1/4 of them would have four or more severe attacks in a month. Not all patients can adequately tolerate the abortive medicines, and they might not be effective. And if there is a frequent migraineur whose frequency is brought down, then his activities of daily living and functionality will improve. So the principles are: start low, go slow. Never change drugs after each attack, because patients would say, "Doctor, aapne dawai di thi, phir mere ko dard ho gaya pichle hafte." It is not that if the patient is not having a pain-free interval, then you have to change or add a medicine. You have to explain it to them that this medicine is not a 100% guarantee that the headache is not going to occur. If a headache occurs in between, that is a rule. It is not an abbreviation or an aberration from what we expect from your treatment. There are various guidelines in different countries, where different countries say that this is the frequency of headaches after which you should start with prophylaxis. Current recommendation is that more than 2 attacks per month should be managed with prophylactic medication. The drugs which we have in our armamentarium are beta blockers, calcium channel antagonists, serotonin antagonists, neuromodulators or anti-epileptic drugs like topiramate and sodium valproate, tricyclic antidepressants, monoamine oxidase inhibitors, riboflavin, magnesium, botulinum toxin, ACE inhibitors, and non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs as a prophylaxis also. I'll not go into the details of each one of them, but I'll touch the salient points one by one. According to the US Headache Consortium guidelines, the drugs which have proven high efficacy and mild to moderate adverse events are grouped into group 1, in which are amitriptyline, divalproex, propranolol, timolol, topiramate and venlafaxine. Group 4 is they have a high efficacy but frequent side effects, which includes methysergide. Group 5 have proven to have limited or no efficacy, and this includes clonazepam, carbamazepine and various other anti-epileptic drugs. And group 2 are lower efficacy and mild to moderate side effects, of which atenolol, fluoxetine, gabapentine, ketoprofen, etc., they fall into this group. Beta blockers is our very famous propranolol. We use it very, very frequently. All of us know about its effect and side effects. It can be used up to 240 milligrams. Practically, personally, I have never gone beyond 160. The side effects is that it has to be given in caution in patients with diabetes. It has to be given in caution with the patients who are asthmatic. In fact, it's to be avoided, and in young males, because it's a drug which is lipid soluble. It crosses the blood-brain barrier and can cause impotence and erectile dysfunction. It has been evaluated in more than 60 clinical trials all over the world. The good point is that it does not cause weight gain. There is no hepatotoxicity. There is no alopecia like sodium valproate. It has a slight edge in females because the polycystic ovarian disease, which is seen in valproate. Other agents, flunarizine, given in 5 to 10 milligram dosage. Higher dosage are more effective but more side effects. Avoid in extreme of age in older individuals because of its potential extrapyramidal side effects. In children, it would be probably one of the very good drugs for management of childhood migraines. It can worsen depression, so it is to be avoided in patients who have significant depression. Tricyclic antidepressants, amitriptyline is the most used drug, as I told you, and we had a discussion just a couple of hours back, that it has got sodium channel blocking capacity. That's why it is used in prophylaxis for migraine. Methysergide is a reserve drug which can be used in most ultimately resistant migraine patients. Sodium valproate was for the first time used in 1980, and its efficacy has been proven in 3 double-blind placebo-controlled trials which have taken into consideration more than 250 patients. The side effects which are seen are alopecia, vomiting, weight gain and tremors. Till date, amongst all the prophylactics which are available, the maximum evidence and the maximum robustness of evidence is seen with topiramate, of which there are at least 3 very large trials in which it has been compared in an intention to treat analysis with responder rate as the end of criteria instead of decrease in headache frequency or intensity. So till date, the most robust evidence is available for topiramate. It is basically acting on sodium channels, calcium channels, AMPA kinase receptor blocker, and a GABA analog activity, apart from having weak carbonic anhydrase inhibition activity. And this is my original publication, and we have found that even very low dose of topiramate, as low as 25 milligram twice a day in patients with frequent migraine, can be very effective as a prophylactic agent. Botulinum toxin, as we have discussed, I am reasonably sure that it does not have a placebo effect also in patients with episodic migraine. In chronic migraine, we have already discussed. Then migraine patients, about the lifestyle modulations, this is the most difficult thing to ensure, this is the most difficult thing to tell, and this is the most difficult thing for a patient to do, because it is free, it has no side effects, and it is very, very effective. The patients who have migraine, they will be going to lengths to get MRI done, PET scan done, do everything you can do, doc sab, but exercise karne ko mat batana. So these things, they do help these patients. We had a trial which we did at AIIMS, in which we randomized patients to receive or not receive autogenic relaxation exercises, and we found that patients who did autogenic relaxation had a significant improvement in their migraine severity. Now, what to give, whom to give, and how to give is the most difficult question, because there is no blanket treatment which suits everybody. What I do is that I use the side effect profile of a drug to create the efficacy profile. For example, if there is a bulky lady who is not depressed, I would start treatment with topiramate, because topiramate, apart from having a good control on headache, also has a weight losing potential. If a patient is depressed and is thinly built, I would put the patient on amitriptyline. If a patient is thin built and there is no evidence of depression, then flunarizine would be my first drug, because it causes a slight increase in body weight. If a patient is a male who is young, then I would avoid beta blockers in them to prevent erectile dysfunction from happening, and I might give sodium valproate sodium valproate would again be my first drug of choice if the patient is having significant mood swings, he has obsessive compulsive disorders. So there is no one drug which can be said that this is the best drug for this particular patient. It has to be taken into consideration about the comorbidities, the physical build, the mental build, and the affordability of the patient, because topiramate is a costly drug and amitriptyline is a very cheap drug. In resistant cases, you might give a trial of methysergide. I have practically never used it. If a patient is having status migranosis, then obviously you have only one drug which is injectable, which is sodium valproate, and you can use that in patients with severe status migranosis. So, as I've already told you, that prophylaxis of migraine is one thing which is entirely patient dependent. There cannot be one drug which can be said that this one Ramban is going to work for every single patient. The most important strategy, according to me, would be to spend some time with the patient, explain to him his nature of the disease, and most importantly, tell him that this is not a severe disease, even if you have a serious headache. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Only one or two short questions. Anybody?
You didn't tell about those headbands. Kafali, Serena, headbands are there now in US.
Yes, I purposely missed out, because they are one piece of equipment which can be used both for acute attacks and for prophylaxis. So there are three modules which are available in Cifelli. It's an external stimulation, transcutaneous stimulation device. We have used it in about 30 patients. In patients who have very frequent migraine and those who are, against those allopathy medicines, they are the ones which feel happy with them. But if you look at the evidence, then the evidence supporting the use of Cifelli is not significant. So I personally give it to those extremely affordable patients who are into a fashion of using something not to be taken by mouth, as you discussed.
Just one comment I wanted to make. Alcohol as a trigger factor. Well, there was a study conducted. The red stuff, that is wine, whiskey, red rum, they precipitate migraine much more than the white stuff, such as vodka and gin. So if you like your drink and you also have migraine, then it will be better if you stick to the white stuff.
I am afraid, but I don't agree to this. There are many patients who would have headaches to vodka exclusively, to gin exclusively. Yeah, I think any type of alcohol helps some people and it does not help some people.
Sir, I am a physician working in peripheral area. Excuse me, here. So, daily I encounter many patients with headache. Many of them may be migraineous. After listening to the course also, we feel that migraine is very, in the treatment of migraine, there is much dissatisfaction.
I am not able to understand anything. Could you speak a bit louder?
Sir, after listening to the course and we feel that migraine treatment there is much patient dissatisfaction. There is no complete satisfaction in the treatment as well as prophylaxis of migraine. Sir, is it because the migraine per se is a condition which cannot be cured better in a better way than the till date? Or is it the that the pathophysiology has not been understood completely? Do you feel that in future we will be in a better position to treat migraine?
I am extremely sorry to say, sir, I completely and utterly disagree with every single statement which you have made. The entire gist of this entire conference you have ruined in a single statement. I completely disagree. Migraine is treatable, it's controllable, it's very, very well controllable. And it is the problem with you. I mean, not with you, with us as a community. How many times have you read headache when you were doing your MD? Never. How many times does a neurologist touch the segment of headache in his textbook? Never. How many times have you seen a single question being asked in the practical examination for the headache? Never. How many times have there been presentations in Indian Academy of Neurology and Headache? Never. How is the headache subsection treated in Indian Academy of Neurology? You'll be amazed. So I completely disagree with you. The problem is with us. We don't want to spend time on headache. If you want to spend on time on headache, this is going to be your bread and butter. Because 60% of patients who come to any neurologist would be some sort of headache at some point of time.
Because in the pathophysiology also, there are hypotheses. Means.
Yeah, if I may just add to your question. In the first topmost reason for why headache treatment fails, the slide which I put up, that perceptions go wrong. So definitely, because you think that migraine is not treatable, there is this dissatisfaction which you talk about. But let me tell you, the first thing is, agar soch mein gadbad hai, to action mein bhi gadbad hai. And we are people, many of us, who practice solely headache. We also have a family to support. We also want to maintain our quality of life. So if there was dissatisfaction, I wouldn't like to say, you asked Sumit how many times a week he plays golf. So if somebody can play golf, surely then he must be, his patients must be satisfied. So change your perception. Definitely this is a thing which we don't want anybody to go away from this meeting with.
Absolutely.
What we are talking about, see, pathophysiology, when Ambar put it, he explained it in such a way because he has to bring you up to the level of current science. But he did not anywhere say that it's not treatable. So therefore, when we talk of refractory also, we are talking of the top rung of 20%, but you are dealing with the below 80%. So therefore, the basics, you should definitely be able to treat. So migraine is a treatable disorder. That is clearly the message we want to send across.
Are there any drugs? Are there any new drugs in the pipeline for...
Yesterday, what I said, that first of all, you have to believe the patient. You have to believe what he says, that I have got headache, I have got severe headache, there is severe pain. You have to believe. Most of us don't believe in that. And therefore, the first step is wrong. The first step is to believe that what the patient is saying, that he is disabled, that you have to understand that. And then only the treatment begins.
Imagine what would have happened if his voice was right. Dr. And Nobin imagine from what you have missed by him not being able to speak.
Dr. Nobin from Kolkata. You have a question. What is the scope of combination therapy to start with?
It's a very difficult question to answer. We usually start with a single drug if the patient is naive. But if the patient is being referred for like a chronic daily headache, a chronic migraine, you can have an inverted pyramid approach. You can start with three or four medicines, see for the effect, and then gradually taper them off one by one. But usually we start with one and add a second one in 2 or 3 months if it is not effective.
I'd just like to make one statement on the same thing. I think one of the reasons why people are shunning headache is that the moment a patient with headache or vertigo comes, you know that minimum 30 to 45 minutes of your time is gone. And I think that is the main thing, because at least for me, when a patient comes, the first thing is, let me first exclude an organic case, as organic cause as far as possible, before I label this patient in the neuralgias or anything else. And of course, as an ENT, the ENT causes are easy for me to exclude. It's the other causes for which I spend time. So I think I agree that the aim should be that it is treatable. And I think that's something we should remember. Thank you.
Yes, last question, yes, please.
I'm Dr. Mahesh Patsalge from Navi Mumbai. I have a lot of patients with migraine who has stopped medication after starting their regular exercises. So whether any study is there, if they start with some amount of exercise and they have good impact, as we can use as a prevention as a migraine. The role of exercise in prevention of migraine attacks.
Role of exercise.
Exercise. Yeah. Yeah, I told you, these are all things which are 100% effective, zero side effects and free. But people will never do it.
No, but any science is there behind that?
Yes, there is. Yeah. That's what I was telling you. Exercise is a form of relaxation. I told you that we have done autogenic relaxation and compared with non-relaxed patients. So exercise is a form of relaxation. It should work.
Hello, sir. Prophylaxis of migraine during pregnancy. Which drugs should be used for prophylaxis of migraine during pregnancy?
Ravi Shankar can answer this better. His famous statement is that if you want to keep a pregnant lady, a lady headache-free, keep her pregnant. Because 30% of patients will not have migraine during pregnancy. 30 to 40% will have a significant reduction, and only 30% will continue to have the same headaches. So again, non-medical treatments should be started. But amitriptyline is one drug which can be tried. After first 6 months, when organogenesis is complete, practically all the drugs can be safely given.